We have a very exciting talk. I'm very, very excited about this because it's about the China that, written by a Western observer, that isn't quite the China we see. For one thing, it's a China that isn't urban. It's a China that isn't crowded. It's a China that isn't polluted. In fact, are you really writing about China, Mike? I'm not sure people here are, you know, because that's the perception we get increasingly now. So I'm very happy to introduce Michael because Michael's talking about the other China, which is where 60% of people live. And just a little bit of information about Michael. Michael started off in the Peace Corps in 1995. 20 years ago. In the joke in China is that 1 year is always like 7 years, dog years, because there's so much transformation. So that would put you firmly into the ancient category time. Michael wrote one of my favorite books about Beijing, called The Last Days of Old Beijing. Yeah, and it's all about the transformation of the city and all the dying bits of old Beijing, which the old Hutong culture. And so in his new book, In Manchuria, he talks about a very different kind of China, where he spends time in a old village that was his wife's ancestral village, and spends a lot of time there understanding how the transformation is coming forth in China. So I will leave you to him. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming out this afternoon. I just want to do my part for the Beijing Winter Olympic bid for 2022 here by showing this was my daily hockey game on the Forbidden City Moat in Beijing. And I like this picture a lot, actually, because it sets up something which I'm going to talk about, which is a lot of policy in China happens at the grassroots level, and then slowly but surely the government or some administrative branch of it will come around and codify it into law. Our hockey game started organically back in 1999. The next year, somebody got and got lumber and put up boards. These were topped by flags. We weren't legally supposed to be here because this is a cultural heritage artifact here. We're at the Forbidden City. But the next year, that didn't stop somebody from selling advertising space here. And these boards became painted. And then the next year, people started selling drinks on the shore, right? So it became sort of sanctioned officially by the park in 2004 when they started charging admission to it, which is sort of the way things go in China. Now it's been shut down because how dare you skate on cultural heritage, right? So we don't have that anymore. Today I'm going to talk about my new book, In Manchuria, A Village Called Wasteland and the Transformation of Rural China. But first, a little background. So we're rooted here of where we're going. Here's Beijing. I'm going to talk about the northeast of China here, this region. Chinese say that their country resembles the outline of a chicken. That would make the northeast its head. It also makes Taiwan the egg, which is a problematic metaphor that people say, no, we're just brooding over it. We're protecting Taiwan here. So the region I'm going to talk about here is north of the Great Wall. It's the area the size of Germany and France combined geographically. It's also equal in population to Germany and France. It's about 110 million people. And I would argue that historically, it's also sort of like the Germany and France of this part of Asia, sort of the crossroads that a lot of different empires have clashed over, including Russia, including the Korean Peninsula here, and migrants that came north into it, Japan, and of course, China proper. Now, it was 20 years ago this summer that I went to China by accident. I was sent out here in Sichuan province in a town called Neijiang. I was a Spanish speaker. I applied to the Peace Corps. I had volunteered with United Farm Workers. I thought for sure Peace Corps would send me to Latin America. Peace Corps called and said, "You're going to Vladivostok." And I said, "They don't speak Spanish there." And they said, "Okay, well, how about Mongolia?" And I said, "Again, that's not quite right." And they said, "Okay, Turkmenistan, which is over here." And I said, "No." And they said, "Kiribati," which was down here in the Pacific. This went on and on. And it wasn't until China was actually the eighth country they offered me. And they said, "It's not Club Med, it's the Peace Corps. Take it or leave it." And although I didn't speak any Chinese and couldn't use chopsticks, I got on a plane. And lived here in Sichuan for 2 years, which was a great place, pre-internet especially, to learn Chinese because I had to. And then in 97, I moved up here to Beijing. I'm going to talk really quickly. I'm just going to show you about four slides of what got me up to the northeast. I lived in Beijing for close to a decade. As the city started remaking itself to host the Beijing Olympics in 2008, I started noticing, of course, that areas I love, neighborhoods I love, places that I would used to go to, dumpling restaurants where I would love to eat, were all being torn down. And it got me thinking again about, if you look at what Jane Jacobs did, say, with New York in the 1950s and 60s, or Herbert Gans did with his work in Boston in the 1950s, where was the book about Beijing? Where was the book that explained why old Beijing was being torn down? Frankly, was it a good thing or a bad thing? And more importantly, is it really a new thing? Beijing has cycled through changes over the last 600 years. And so I moved to this courtyard apartment here, this courtyard home. Here's my bike, my roof that needs weeding. I found this on the internet. And it wasn't your typical courtyard home. It was typical in the sense that post-1955 Beijing, it was quite typical. And that this former mansion, or manor, more accurately, had been subdivided for several families to move into after Beijing became the capital again. This is just on the edge of Tiananmen Square, that southwest corner of Tiananmen Square. Dashilar is the name of the neighborhood. There are four courtyards here, it had been subdivided into, and in 2005, I moved back to the very coldest, dampest room in the courtyard, back here where I lived for 3 years, researching my book, The Last Days of Old Beijing. This room has three people, this room has one person, this room has an elderly lady, this room where I'm standing has three people. So we're all living back in here. My landlord, or my neighbors, called me Dadiju, big landlord, because I had two rooms and they all had one. There's a cold water tap here. You see where our laundry is hanging, and there's a propane stove here that we would cook on. This being 21st century Beijing, I had no toilet, but I had really good broadband internet because they ran the wire over my roof and down into my house. The worst part of this, and this was all preparation for living in the countryside, was of course the outhouse, which was down the lane, a good 4 minute walk. And starting in 2005 and the run up to the Olympics, advertising started permeating every corner of Beijing, to the point when I would walk into the toilet and squat down, I would see this guy who was telling you all the symptoms you should be checking yourself for. I also like, you know, in the run up to the Olympics, they had a rectification of names campaign where direct Chinese to English translations such as this had to be updated. So this became the Proctology Hospital. But it's a reminder of one thing I really love about working in China and doing research in China and writing about China is how direct and frank the language is and how direct and frank the people can be as well. I need to find this guy's agent and see why he got this gig and if he knows about it. This is the last picture I'm going to show you of Beijing, and this was sort of a springboard for why I moved to the Northeast and started this next round of research. Like I said, I think it's time to write a book when the book you want to read doesn't exist. I had not seen a book documenting those changes in Beijing. And then my students got me thinking about the next book, actually. So I was quite lucky that in this neighborhood, I taught the same kids, grade 4, grade 5, grade 6. I followed them as they progressed, and I got to know their families quite well. These kids right here are grade 4, and you see they're wearing the school uniform, the young pioneer kerchief, and the yellow safety hat that all Beijing kids have to wear to alert traffic to their presence, even though in our neighborhood there's no cars, right, in this hutong. These kids are grade 4. These girls are my 6th grade students, who I've known for 3 years, grade 4, grade 5, grade 6. They're not wearing the school uniform or the red pioneer kerchief because they don't get to go to middle school in Beijing. Their parents are officially Waidiren, right? They're from outside. They migrated into Beijing to work. Per Beijing law and Chinese law, kids who are children of migrants can attend elementary school up until the middle school entrance exam. Then they have to go back to their home village and attend middle school there. And it got me thinking again, like I said, I'd lived for 10 years in Beijing. I'm right on the edge of Tiananmen Square. I've done all the research for this book. Well, what now? If I'm writing about urban China, that's one thing. But what's going on in rural China? And really, where are these girls going back to? Right? What are they going to find when they go home? So, Dashilar, this neighborhood is 1 square mile. Vatican City is 1 square mile. Vatican City has 700 people in it. Dashilar is 1 square mile and has 57,000 people in it. So the research for this book, you know, took me through hundreds of interviews and looking at history through the lens of the last 600 years of this neighborhood. But now in order to follow sort of the story of what was going on in rural China, I swapped this environment for this one. And I think this is quite beautiful, actually. You know, in the Northeast, they don't call their dirt just dirt. They call it hei tu di. They call it the black earth. It's as rich and saturated as spent coffee grounds, if you can picture that. So I moved straight northeast from Beijing, went over the Great Wall, up here into Jilin Province, which is the heart of what historically is called Manchuria. A quick word about the word Manchuria. You know, in China today, everybody calls it Dongbei. They call it the Northeast. This area has had many names over its past 400 years, especially, of recorded history and of recorded maps. But the word Manchuria long predates the Japanese puppet state that was here from 1931 to 45. That was Manchukuo. Sometimes people confuse, oh, if you're saying Manchuria, isn't that equivalent to saying the Japanese puppet state, Manchukuo? It's not, and in fact, the word Manchuria stayed in use even after the Japanese puppet state fell. Even Zhou Enlai and Liu Shaoqi used it in personal correspondence when they were talking about this region. It didn't really become the Northeast until the Soviets left in 55 when they withdrew from Dalian, and people started calling it Dongbei, Dongbei, Dongbei. So to a Chinese person now, they just know it as the Northeast, right? But frankly, in the Northeast isn't a very good title for a book, and I'm talking about historically in this region too, and so that's why I'm using the word Manchuria. So I went 600 miles northeast of Beijing. That's equivalent from getting on a train here at Union Station and going up to central Maine, in the same direction also. Again, this area shares a long border, the entire border with North Korea. Here's Vladivostok. I'm getting closer to my Peace Corps or original offer here. I'm actually closer geographically and culturally in many ways to Vladivostok and Pyongyang than I am to Beijing. Right? Okay, so the village I moved to is just north of Jilin here on the Songhua River, and it's called Huangdi, or Wasteland. Just like in Beijing, I thought I may as well make myself useful while I'm here, so I started teaching at the elementary school. See these kids out here in February with their basketball. They've pounded the court down to like a Wimbledon-quality sheen here. This was the school my wife went to. That's how I ended up in Wasteland of all the villages. My wife since left, went to Beijing for university, went to Berkeley for law school, and works internationally. But as a little girl, she went to this school right here, and her mom went to this school as well. And so in your nice introduction, May, you mentioned this is my wife's ancestral village. The ancestral part of it goes back two generations. And that's actually really common for the Northeast. It's another thing I liked about moving up here. In Sichuan, where I was a Peace Corps volunteer, you could go into a village and see an ancestral tablet that went back 17, 18, 19 generations. The Northeast, especially if you're Han Chinese, you migrated here much, much, much later. Perhaps in the late 19th century, more likely like my wife's family, you came up here in the 1920s, 1930s from Shandong, from Hebei, fleeing famine or fleeing unemployment and looking for opportunities. And so the entire region sort of has this pioneer American West aspect to it that I quite liked. And frankly, as a writer, it's easier for me. After doing Beijing has, you know, in China, you always hear China has 5,000 years of history. Although they say it, China has 5,000 years of history. The Northeast really recorded history goes back about 400 years, which is, you know, equal to when the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock or Shakespeare wrote Romeo and Juliet. So for me as a writer, I like this too. It was a bit more digestible. When I first moved here, I thought I was going to be writing stories like that of Mr. Meng. Mr. Meng is a lumberjack who lives not far from Wasteland, and he has his claim to fame in China is being the first Chinese to see an alien, an extraterrestrial. Now, Northeasterners are a bit like Minnesotans are characterized, or perhaps people from Maine are, New Englanders in the States. The rest of China sees him as a bit eccentric or a bit touched in the head. So it wasn't a surprise to anybody, I think, that the first Chinese to say he saw an alien came from the Northeast. Mr. Meng is somebody whose story I followed for a while, actually. I thought it was interesting. He saw a flash of light on the mountain here one night, went out to investigate, saw some wreckage, didn't know what it was. That night he was sleeping in bed when he found himself levitating, passed through the wall, was up in a spaceship. And I said, okay. And he said, and then one of the aliens made love to me. And I said, okay. And I said, did you tell your wife? And he said, oh, no, no, but I told the media. Which cracked me up. So he kind of went viral before there was such a thing in China, to the point where like Japanese tourists started bringing him televisions and other electronics. A Malaysian man brought him a cow. I saw Mr. Meng as this great example of sort of this Northeast pioneer, you know, spirit of self-invention, because over time he became so well known that he started getting job offers off this busted logging commune. And he ended up getting a job running the boiler at a Harbin, the provincial capital, at a university there, which meant he got his little boy off the farm and into a middle school. I saw him as this great example of self-invention. My wife saw him as a great example of the Northeastern art of bullshitting. But I will say that his story kept getting better and better, to the point now that when you see him, he's embarrassed to talk about it. He puts his head down. when students recognize him, he says, oh, no, that was somebody else. It wasn't me, which I think is great. But he extended the story to include the fact that he actually impregnated the alien, and that in 60 years on a distant planet, she will give birth to a peasant. So he actually introduced interstellar, you know, class consciousness to these relations as well. One thing I thought was so funny too about this is I asked him to draw the alien for me, and he drew a series of concentric rings that got wider in the middle with little stubby hands and tapered down, did two legs. And I realized that the only billboard between town and his commune was for Michelin tires, and it was the Michelin man. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. Okay, so I thought that was the book I was going to do. I thought I was going to sort of replicate Pearl Buck's field research she did with her husband, John Losing Buck, when they were going, before she wrote The Good Earth, when they would go out to farms and sort of collect lore, nursery rhymes, recipes, that sort of thing. And I thought I was going to do a sort of encyclopedia of Northeast history and what kids were going through living in the school there. I was going to focus on one piece of land. Dr. Lar, my Beijing neighborhood is 1 square mile. I thought in Wasteland, this village, I would also focus on 1 square mile of land. Here it is in winter. Here it is at thaw, which is about right now. You see that hay to di, that really dark soil. Here it is come spring, or early summer, I should say, when the rice is in. Interestingly, you know, this village, they plant a very high quality grade of rice, and a lot of them grow it organically, actually. They were among the first villages to do this in this region. And although the Northeast only grows about 1/8 of China's total rice production, they grow over half of the short grain sticky variety that we eat in sushi. So it's like if you go across the map to Hokkaido, the northern island of Japan, they grow the same crop. And so farmers in this village are a bit unique too, in that they can make a living growing only one crop a year, planting in April, harvesting in September. So I do want to put a caveat in here that this is not a typical Chinese farm, but then again, there is no such thing as a typical Chinese farm. A cotton grower is much different than a pork producer, is much different than a rice grower, and there's geographic and land issues as well. So here's the crop coming in summer. Here's the crop when it's in full ear, late August. And then here we are at harvest. So I love the foothills out here. It was a gorgeous place to live. I mean, as May said in her introduction, look at the sky and these low-hanging clouds. It really reminded me a lot of Northern California, sort of Sonoma County without the valley, if you can picture that. The Songhua River is here, and these foothills hug us on three sides in this area. It's this fertile floodplain. It took a long time, as it does anything in China, right, that isn't recorded, to figure out why the place was named Wasteland. I did figure out that it was founded in 1722, or at least the emperor had passed through then, Kangxi. But this village out here is named Lonely Outpost. This village is named Mud Town. This village is named the Dunes. And this village is named Zhang's Smelly Ditch. And so Wasteland sort of fit into this pattern, right? And what people started, the theory is, from locals anyway, because again, none of this is recorded officially. The local administrative government would burn their records for cooking fuel. You know, in the 70s and 80s, nothing's recorded anymore. The theory as to why Wasteland is named this, and these villages have these horrible names, is because the land was so good, they wanted other settlers to pass by and not settle down there, or they wanted bandits or soldiers to pass through, as many soldiers did. Japanese have been through here, Russians have been through here, the Kuomintang has been through here, warlords have been through here, communists have been through here, and so forth. Whether that's true or that's apocryphal, I can't confirm. I rented a farmhouse, so these are my onions here and my corn. The outhouse is here, closer walk, no advertising, thankfully. This is my grape trellis growing here. It's a very simple farmhouse. You know, I shared it. I have this half right here. This half is owned by a Manchu gentleman, a fisherman named Mr. Guan, who's a character in the book. And when you step inside the house, you step up on a kong. A kong is that prototypical northeastern bed made of brick, and you feed it outside here. You can see the burn marks. Outside the house is a vent into which you stuff dried rice chaff. In the wintertime, these houses have rice chaff piled up beside them, taller than the homes themselves. And it's really hot, you know, in the winter. It's usually minus 18 degrees Fahrenheit here in wintertime, but I'd be sitting in my shorts and a t-shirt. And you start to smell like baked bread after a while. It's kind of a nice sensation that you're baking atop your oven here. I also like when I came home at night, I would step up onto the stage, which was a nice place to do my notes, because the entire house was this kong. Now, when I first moved there was only one road in the village. This is 2010, summer of 2010. Hongqi Lu. Again, people dispute, is this red flag because it's post-liberation, Communist Party red, or is it Hongqi as in a banner, a Manchu banner, which was the name of the military administrative districts that the Manchu would use to govern their region. No one can say for sure. But what I do know for sure is that my first summer there, I started getting this weird deja vu feeling that I was living the Beijing book again. Because the first summer, these trucks came in, dumped these stones here, imported laborers from elsewhere in the province came in, broke the stone by hand, and started widening the road to double its current width. That incensed Auntie Yi, a main character in the book. She has been in this village her entire life. She went to elementary school under the Japanese in Manchukuo. She can still sing the Manchukuo national anthem in Japanese and count to 10 in Japanese. But she's a lifelong party member, and she's a lifelong village cadre, a village administrator who was in the government. And what incensed her about this change in the village is that the government did not pay for this road project. The government did not pay to butter her house yellow either, so it looked nice for passerby. The government did not pay for this wasteland's first lawn here, this strip of sod that tore up her poppies. And the government did not pay for these streetlights with this advertisement for the person or the entity that did pay for this project, which is a local agribusiness called Eastern Fortune Rice, which I'll talk about in a second. Auntie Yi asked me a question that no one had ever asked me. In hundreds of interviews in 5 years of writing a book about Beijing, no one had ever asked me this question. How do you know when a place has developed just enough? In other words, when do you stop that march toward improvement, improvement, improvement? Wasteland farmers are among the richest in the Northeast, which means they're among the richest in all of China. Your average Chinese farmer makes about $1,500 a year. Wasteland farmers make over 50% more than that. They make about $2,200 to $2,300 a year. Most of them have their own homes, which may look a bit ramshackle, but on the inside they're quite nice and they're toasty. As you saw in that picture, there's a brand new elementary school. They don't consider themselves luohua, backward, at all. And many people there didn't feel like they needed a company to come in and improve what they had already spent 50 years doing, which is opening the paddies, originally opened by Korean migrants, and then settling this region. So for Auntie Yi, this was a big issue. How do you know when a place has developed just enough? And part of this book is trying to answer that question, especially when it comes to what China is now calling the new countryside. Come winter, this was my backyard. Previously, I showed you a picture of the house here, and there's corn. This is my Manchu roommates drying corn out here, a traditional Manchu staple in wintertime. They're putting up, these cranes are going up, and by springtime, these appeared. And so this was like phase two of what was going on in the village. This is a trend that started in about 2005 and is accelerating now to the national level. The Northeast has often been a place of experimentation, of policy experimentation, and this village happens to be one in which this policy was being piloted, and now you're seeing it rolled out and promulgated nationwide. And it was that a local company could start subleasing villagers' farmland and then urge them to, I'll explain this more of this in a second, and they would urge the farmers to leave their single-story courtyard homes, plow those courtyard homes under, plant more rice there. The farmers then would move to these high-rise apartments, which they would own, and then they would officially become urbanites, right? So in the company and the government's mind, it's a win-win. You're taking people out of what they deem as dilapidated housing, you're doing a better use of land, and you're moving people into efficient modern housing with central heat and so forth. But as often happens, you know, and again, I understand the reasons for this, I should say. China's facing three very daunting things when it comes to farming right now. One is the workforce population is aging rapidly. The average age of a farmer in Wasteland was about 67 years old. There's no 4-H clubs at school. I never saw any of my students in the field. I wasn't even allowed in the field. My wife is 38 years old. She grew up in this village. She has never been in a rice field. So that has been going on for generations now, a family saying, no, you're going to school. You know, you're not going to work. This happens elsewhere in China too, but it's very marked in this area. So one, there's a shrinking workforce population of people to work on the farm. Two, there's higher and higher demands for the land that does exist. An area the size of New York State has been plowed under and made into urban centers. And so China is trying to get more off of less land. It's trying to do a lot of land reclamation projects. It's also trying to get higher yields off the land that it has. One reason you'd tear down a farmer's house and plant rice there and move them vertically. And the third thing is soil pollution and pollution in general is quite acute in China right now. There's an area the size of the state of Maryland that was finally declassified last year that's too polluted to farm at all. And so that land is coming offline. The government says, look, if everybody in this room right now all has an acre plot of rice, if we all come to the granary here, dump that rice in, a food safety official can't check how much fertilizer did you use, what's the soil like in your corner of the village. They're saying, look, it's much easier if you have a sort of an agribusiness coming in and managing this collectively at a large scale. It's easier for food safety and it's certainly more efficient. Now, you can imagine what China's model for this is. In every single briefing of the Ministry of Agriculture, maybe every is hyperbole, in most briefings by the Ministry of Agriculture, they cite the United States. And they say, look, as of 1992, the American census stopped counting farmers. Farmers are statistically insignificant in America now, and they have been for 20 years. Also, you know, in America now, 9% of our farms produce about 3/4 of our food. So America has scaled up. And China's urging American agribusinesses to come in and do this as well. There's a Minnesota-based conglomerate named Cargill, huge agribusiness, that has a poultry operation in Anhui, where Pearl Buck set the good earth, that processes 65 million chickens a year. And already they're saying this is peanuts in the scale of China. But the government likes this because you can put barbed wire around the area, you can employ locals to work in the plant, you can control the medicine the birds are given, you can control the food, the feed they're given, and so forth. So Wasteland's a bit unique. Actually, it's a local grown agribusiness that's making these changes. Another character in the book is Sanjo. This is Francis, my wife's uncle, actually. And he's 67 years old. He's representative of a typical wasteland farmer. This is his house here, which he's improved over the years. And he says, look, I don't like this idea because I've lived through 50 years of economic experimentation in this area. I've lived through the Great Leap Forward. I lived through the Cultural Revolution. I've lived through mandatory state procurement of grain. And now, starting in 2006, you know, China abolished all agricultural taxes on farmers. He said, I'm finally free. I don't have to give any of my output to the state. I'm free of taxes. I'm free to sell my crop on my own. And he'll point out that, you know, rice has doubled in price in the last 6 years. Now, costs of production are up too, but he farms 1.5 acres, about the size of an American football field. And on that mere plot, just picture an American football field, he makes a living. You know, he makes about $2,500 a year, which puts him among one of the wealthier of China's farmers, if you're looking on average. So the way this works, so the program is such that Chinese farmers right now don't own their farmland, of course. They don't own their field because all land belongs to the state, but they now have the freedom to sublease their land. And so what's officially happening is farmers like Sanjo are being, their door is being knocked on, and a representative from an agribusiness will come and say, look, we want to contract your land. You don't have to work it. Here's a contract. We have the rights for 3 years to use your assigned plot. We'll farm it, you don't have to touch it. We'll give you a guaranteed price, right? And so it's sort of hedging, you're betting, if you sign that contract, you're A, saying I don't wanna work on the farm anymore, I wanna pursue other employment in the city, let's say, or have a shop in town, but you're also betting on that fixed price the company is giving you is going to be a good deal 3 years out. So you're betting that the price of rice won't keep rising and rising and rising, which it had. And Sanjo in the book, I follow him through this period, is very happy that for him, short term, he came out ahead. He made about 30% more money by not signing the contract and farming himself than he would have had he subleased it to the company. But he feels a lot of pressure. And those pressures began at the very top of the Chinese political chain here. This is then President Hu Jintao visiting Wasteland in 2007. He came to Eastern Fortune Rice. Usually when a Chinese official goes to a farm, they put on Wellingtons, you know, they put on their Zhongshan suit, and they go out in the fields and they're you know, seen as one of the people. They're photographed with the farmers. Hu Jintao didn't bother with that, right? He went to the agribusiness itself. Here's the manager, who again is a local boy. People don't have animosity toward him in the village necessarily, not personally anyway, but he's wearing a tie here, right? Not the Zhongshan suit, and Hu Jintao is inspecting this. And Eastern Fortune's big coup was they got their rice served at official state banquets. So now it's a well-known brand in China. to the point now where our tallest billboard in town says, Da Zhao Dongbei Di Yichun, right? Make the first village of the Northeast. So now if you search the village name on Chinese search engines, it's sort of becoming a prototypical model of how agriculture could follow in the rest of China. But there are big differences here. First thing you notice, these are flat fields that are very easy to do mechanized farming in and to scale up and to try to get more off the land and do it more efficiently. The other thing, as I mentioned to you, is these lands are not stretching back 17 to 20 generations. Sanjo, the farmer I just showed you, his family's been farming this since they got to the village in 1953. People don't have those strong ties to the land and are a little bit more willing to sign it over to a company, let's say. And the third is that the Northeast in general has been this hotbed of experimentalism over the past 400 years especially. And I want to talk about this rather quickly, actually, because I want to sit down with May and talk. But briefly, I mean, I'll talk about this for 10 minutes. One thing I loved about working in the Northeast is how different it is from the rest of China. And it's a point I want to make in terms of this experimental agriculture that's going on there. Because for the past 100 years especially, about 150 actually, successive regimes have tried to bend the Northeast to their will, to their narrative, and they've all failed miserably. And we can begin with the Manchu, the natives from this area, who by the 19th century, after they'd established the Qing dynasty and enlarged China to its present-day state with Xinjiang, with Tibet, some would say Taiwan, Inner Mongolia, the Northeast, by that point in the late 19th century, more Manchu had left the Northeast and lived in Beijing than they actually lived in their home region. To the point now where there's 6,800 languages on the planet, and they say about half will go extinct by the end of this century, but none were once as prominent as Manchu. And I actually went up to this village north of Chichihar, if you know this region, where the last three native speakers of Manchu live. We're down to three remaining native speakers. This was their failed attempt at luring tourists to this area. They could not lure tourists because it's very politically sensitive to express minority culture in China, even if you're somebody like the Manchu, who's largely been Hanicized or Sinicized over the past 100 years. I did find in this village, though, this is Manchu script here. This is at the school. It says, passing on Manchu culture begins with me. There is a teacher, age 39, who was taught by his grandmother some of the language. And so he's leading classes in teaching Manchu. He can't do it during school hours, though, because ironically in China, if you're studying a foreign language in school, it has to be English. It can't be Manchu, even if you're ethnic Manchu. So the kids are doing it after school. A little flicker left of that era. Also, there was attempts throughout the 1700s and 1800s the Manchu made to keep Han Chinese from migrating into this region. They built a 1,000-mile wall called the Willow Palisade. It's really more of a barrier than it was a wall. This was the moat here, this sandy area. And these sunflowers were the edge of a berm that used to go up. And these trees were once lashed together with rope. And it was a borderland that would protect the area from Han Chinese, Mongolians, and Koreans from settling in here. Wasteland is within the border of this. No one in my village knows about the Willow Palisade. Not my Manchu roommate, not the kids at school. My wife had never even heard of it. You're not taught that in school. You're taught the Great Wall, right? You're not taught anything that's minority culture officially, especially for the national exam. There are some markers for the Willow Palisade, but here you see some Manchu farmers jumping on one of them. Locals keep stealing the stone because it's really good quality stone, so they break it up and use it for their homes or for their driveways instead. Moving forward, the Russians tried to occupy this region starting at about 1900. They built a railway going across, from Moscow to Vladivostok, the Trans-Siberian, that cut through, it was officially the Trans-Manchurian, it cut through the northeast corner of the Northeast. One big change that's happened in the Northeast the last 20 years is that when I first visited Harbin, this is St. Sophia's Orthodox Cathedral, a remnant of that Russian occupation. In the 1990s, you couldn't see this church from the street. There were apartment blocks built all the way around it. When you did get through the apartment blocks and came in, this was all boarded up, anti-imperialist slogans on it, and it was being used as a warehouse for a department store, right? But so many state-owned enterprises started going bust in the 1990s that the Northeast devolved from the Beijing central economy and had to raise its own revenues. And one way it did it was to restore a lot of this old colonial architecture and rebrand them patriotic education bases. So unlike Tianjin or Shanghai or Beijing or Guangzhou, when you're in the Northeast, you can actually see these artifacts that are still existing around in the heart of cities. It's sort of like a picture of a board game called Empire, and these playing pieces have been left behind. You still see these old Russian railroad stations out in the middle of nowhere. I noticed that the brighter the station, the more desolate the surrounding was, as if it was urging you to get off the train, please, please. And you see that going forward, too. This is on the border with Siberia, where you see that old Russian wooden water tower next to a brighter pink Soviet-style box. After the Russians came the Japanese, who defeated the Russians in 1905 in the Russo-Japanese War. In the book, I talk about Jack London was the Hearst correspondent and was sent off after the success of Call of the Wild to try to follow the battles. And those remnants are all over the Northeast, too. Japan really, this is a Japanese-built museum in Lushun in Port Arthur. The Japanese tried to show they were a civilizing influence and they would be different than the Russians. And in the book, I interviewed the curator of this museum, whose job it was to protect it during the Cultural Revolution. And he said Zhou Enlai did not make a phone call. He doesn't know of any real situation in China where Zhou Enlai actually did make a phone call to protect something. Instead, he boarded it up, painted slogans on it, put all the expensive stuff downstairs, the valuable stuff, kept some rather worthless artifacts in his office. And when the Red Guards would come to want to smash things, he'd act, if you must, you can take this. And they would make a show of smashing it and go on their way. This guy did such a good job that his job now in Dalian is to scrub that city museum. It was the Bo Xi Lai Museum, the disgraced former mayor of Dalian. And so this longtime party guy, his job now is to take Dalian's museum out of the throes of worship of Bo Xi Lai. You also see these old Japanese and Russian-built hotels on the train lines. When you're traveling the Northeast, you don't have to take buses. There's trains that go to every nook and cranny of the area, unlike other places in China. This is a hotel in 1912, a Japanese-built hotel. Note the road is being built here. 1912, same hotel, 2012. The road is still being built, which I like. This has not been preserved. And a lot of the things you see in the Northeast, unlike other places of China, they haven't been posted with historical markers reminding you of what happened here. This was the hotel to which the Japanese hid Puyi, the last emperor of China, who had abdicated in 1912. Had fled, finally in the 19, he wanted to go to the British legation, had hoped to go to Oxford, the British wouldn't let him in. The Japanese in Beijing took him into their compound, they installed him in Tianjin for a while, and finally in the 1930s brought him to that hotel and kept him hidden there for several months because they said, you can be emperor of our new puppet state called, or they didn't call it a puppet state, our new independent state called Manchukuo. And this was Puyi's palace. In China, everything with Puyi now is puppet. He's the puppet emperor. This is the puppet emperor's palace that he lived in starting in 1932 when he was made chief executive of this puppet state. And when you go inside, you see a puppet Puyi. There he is, gleefully conferring with a Japanese general. A word about Manchukuo. I shouldn't make light of something that was so brutal, but I should say that people in the Northeast have a very different relationship with their Japanese history than the rest of China. It is true that Japan invaded in 1931. It is true that now the anniversary that's marked in the Northeast is no longer the start of the Korean War, but instead on September 18th at 9:18 in the morning, all traffic stops, classrooms stop, an air raid siren blows, and that's the time and the date, at least the date, in 1931 when the Japanese formally occupied or invaded the Northeast. Here you see this propaganda poster of unity, the Manchukuo flag on the left, Japanese flag in the middle, the Vichy Republic of China flag on the right. And there's these reminders around town. This is a state executive building for Manchukuo. Japan called this architectural style Rising Asia, and they still remain. These buildings are still in use. And you still see these Shinto shrines around town in Changchun. I asked the city official, why has this not been torn down? And he said, because people like to roller skate here. So that was quite sweet. I don't think that's true, but I like the pragmatism there. And you do still see things like this, the Unit 731. This is where Japan's answer to Joseph Mengele did his experiments on live prisoners of war. Over 3,000 people perished in this camp up in Harbin. Now when you visit it, there's a middle school here, so you're looking at bone saws and stuff, but you're hearing these laughter of middle school kids next door, which is quite incongruous, but also nice. But I want to talk briefly about why the Northeast has a different historical relationship with Japan than the rest of China. this Millions to Manchuria campaign. This is a Japanese campaign. This poster says, to Manchuria. You see the Japanese flag here. Starting in the late 1930s, Japanese farm communities were failing on a grand scale. Japan had an idea that they could take second-born, third-born kids, put them on a boat, put them up in the northeast of China. They could go to villages that they would rename after their Japanese home village, and they would replicate a society, an agrarian society there. These farmers were told they were getting 25 virgin acres that they would open by themselves. It wasn't the case. They showed up, they were given a single bolt-action rifle, many of them, and they were put in border areas that the Soviet army was likely to invade when it finally turned its attention towards Japan, or in areas where there was a lot of Chinese guerrilla activity to get them out of there. 300,000 people came over, mostly women and children, remained in 1945. The men had been called up for the draft. The Japanese army had turned tail and fled south as the Soviet army started invading. And this is a site, this is in Fengzheng. This is in the Songhua River, 2 hours downstream from Harbin, where thousands of Japanese mothers and their children waited on these docks for what they were told were going to be Japanese rescue ships coming to get them. A secret Japanese communique revealed that a general instead said their only alternative is suicide. And in fact, that's what happened. The women put their children on the shore and stepped into the current here. Now, local farmers adopted many of these kids and raised them. Fengzheng is a very interesting city to go to. It's actually a county because the street signs are in Chinese and Japanese. You don't see English language schools for after-school programs. You see Japanese language schools. The county official says about 1/5 of all county residents have been to Japan. A lot of Japanese come over in August to sweep the graves of their mothers and the things that have been found, to the point where in the 1960s, Zhou Enlai himself even opened a cemetery or dedicated a cemetery in this town for Japanese farmers who had perished and the Chinese mothers that raised them and the orphans that remained. And Zhou Enlai said, this shows that the Japanese were also victims of the war. Japanese civilians also suffered from Japanese imperialism. And a local historian, this man agrees, a Chinese man, and he's been trying to get this posted as a patriotic education base as well. And he says, like everybody elsewhere in China calls our county traitors, but we had a very different experience with the war than the rest of the country did. Now, at that cemetery in 2011, a new monument went up honoring the names of 500 Japanese farmers whose bones had been found recently. Chinese nationalists from the south got on a train, came up, spray painted it, smashed it. A bulldozer took it under it the next day. Now the cemetery is closed. So again, one thing I was interested about this book too is you're looking at these cycles of agriculture that are going on, this experimentation, but you also have this other cycle of history in the Northeast that's still turning and is still unresolved, to the point where there's still American POWs, survivors of the Bataan Death March, who were held in this area. This is their prisoner of war camp. In the book, I talked to a guy who parachuted in with only a Mauser, and he was going to try to liberate these POWs amidst 30,000 Japanese soldiers who didn't know the war was over. And he's led a charge to try to change the narrative of how this museum is going to be portrayed in the city right now. So again, these contested histories that continue on and on and on. It goes forward to the Korean War when the U.S. bombed the Yalu Bridge here and MacArthur was sacked for this operation, which I talk about in the book. Now when you go to it, you just see, you know, here's a dotted line going to North Korea with the Ferris wheel. A plaque just says the Americans bombed it November 8th to November 14th, 1950. It doesn't tell you all the backstory, including in the book, there's a man from my village who at 16 years old waited on the Chinese side. When the Americans were done bombing the bridge, the river froze 5 days later, and he and 130,000 other Chinese troops marched across and joined the Korean War and turned the tide against MacArthur and the Americans. So a lot of what I'm doing in this book is sort of, like I said, detailing this agricultural change, but also looking at these historical changes. You know, the cult of Mao, I have four more slides I'll show you, was quite strong in this area, but it's diminished so much in recent years. This is the last big statue of Chairman Mao that remains. This is in Shenyang. These are laid off factory workers actually praying to him and bowing to him and leaving him flowers. And when you sit here during the daytime, you see family after family, not irregularly, coming up and offering prayers to Saint Mao looking for work. Three more slides now. Back in the village though, any communist propaganda, you know, is fading on these old granaries because people have moved on to the capitalist stage of their lives. These old slogans like agriculturestudies.gi, which was a commune that was popularized in the 1970s, are also fading away to the point now, you know, this is what our village looks like now. Our entrance is an advertisement for the agribusiness, for Dongfu rice instead. And right as I was ready to leave, the head of the company called me in for an interview. They were very open with me and very welcoming. And he said, oh, I have good news. I said, what? He said, we're changing the name of the village. And I said, I like Wasteland. That's a beautiful name. It's older than the United States of America itself. And he said, no, I have a much better idea. We're going to change it to Eastern Fortune after our company. So the village is literally transformed from not only economically a company town, but it's transforming to geographically and physically a company town as well. And this is the last slide I'll show you. This was Mr. Guan, my roommate. He decided to lease his fields to the company. But for one last time, his family got together and harvested their fields by hand and did it the old-fashioned way, where they spread their grains out on the road to dry. And this was, I'll end on this, is sort of, you know, going off into the sunset. It was really something to watch, that all of those generations of farming, just there it goes, off into the road, and they signed a contract, and they were all done. And they're quite happy, I should add. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
So what occurred to me was you've written about the last days of old Beijing, mm-hmm. and you're writing about the last days of Wasteland, basically. And now you're living in Singapore, and you're going to write about Singapore. I'm wondering whether the Singaporeans should be concerned. But what is this urge about capturing something that's dying or moving away? What spurs you on to do that?
I don't know if they're actually dying as they are just cycling, mm-hmm. right? When you take the long view here, that like the last days of old Beijing is sort of a joke as a title. It wasn't my idea, frankly, but it makes sense because in that book I talk about there's always been a last days of an old Beijing, that every dynasty or every regime that's occupied Beijing remade the city in their image, right? And with the farming techniques that are going on here, you know, an audience member at a previous talk was really helpful. He stood up and said, but you know, you're just describing what they did in the 60s with communal farming, but now it's a company managing it instead. And a character in the book actually said, like, when we first came here, it was landlords that were running our farm or controlling our farm. Then it was village cadres, you know, administrators, and now it's a manager that's changing like that. So I'm interested in capturing those moments where the needle is just about to tick over. And I think the reason for that is I love reading books that are 100 years or 200 years old that do that as well. I still like reading Dickens. I still like reading, you know, I teach Moby Dick to my students for that same reason. You see these industries dying.
So transformation is just what gets you going. You know, one of the problems I think you've mentioned before in previous interviews too is that the problem of writing a book about China, and because of China's geopolitical significance now, is everybody expects you to sort of explain China. I mean, some of the in Manchuria, for example, is not a very easy China book in that sense, because it goes against all these stereotypes. And I've also heard it compared to Perlis Buck's The Good Earth, mm-hmm. and in Patagonia.
Yeah, that was my model in Patagonia.
Yeah, nobody is asking Chatwin to sort of explain you know, Argentina or something like that. But somehow, do you find that you have to fight against this weight or expectation?
It's exhausting, actually. And you know, the writer Ian Fraser, who wrote Great Plains, which is another model for this book, he said to me, "You know, your challenge is what your problem here is." I said, "What?" He said, "You're ruining the fantasy." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Americans are faced with a deluge of China information now every day, newspaper, radio, television, by very good correspondents. Those are all portraying a China of a certain kind of China and a certain topic of China. When you write about happy farmers and you know the vicissitudes of history and this bending narrative that Japanese maybe aren't so evil or considered so evil in this area, you're going against that fantasy in a way, right? And so, but that's what's fun as a writer, I suppose, right? I mean, you're facing this right now with the book you're doing, right?
I'm writing about a one-child policy, and one hand
you have to put that in quotes, right?
It's not really a one-child policy. And but you know, I think the issue that writers want to do is they want to have a book that has a shelf life that goes beyond, you know, a newspaper, right? So you don't want a book that's full of statistics and numbers, because those change over time. You want to get it to sort of greater truths that will encapsulate a certain period in time.
Especially with China, you can't keep up. You know, in Beijing, they put out a new map of the city now. It was 6 months. I think they're now there for like 3 months because the roads changed so quickly and so forth. And so do people's lives. I mean, that's the hard thing with, you know, Capote faced it with In Cold Blood, where he couldn't finish the book until the criminals were actually executed, right? I'm not comparing myself to Capote here, but I had a hard time with the Beijing book too, of like, where does this end? Because the changes are so ongoing. Do you keep chronicling, you know? And the same thing with this book, where it was like, well, where's my cutoff point where I say, aha, the change has occurred, now we can stop.
But at the same time, you're also writing, and what gets me interested in this book is also because what's unusual about it is a sort of a timeless quality about it. There are things that don't change,
yeah,
or that change very, very slowly, and that is very different from the rest of China.
I structured this around the seasons, which are eternal, right? The farm is always going to be there. It's been there for 100 years. Somebody else might be planting it or picking it, but the farm will probably still be there in 100 years. So that's the eternal. And then there's that ephemeral wheel of all these regimes, all these people who have walked across this land and changed. Yeah.
Moving on to a so-called hot button topic current about China, the urbanization issue, which is what you've talked about too, that this China's on this big move to get a lot of the people into cities. It's for the first time ever now, it's more urban than, so where does it all go? Where do all the happy farmers go?
Well, one solution recently I thought was really ingenious is Wasteland, this village, recently became part of Jilin City. And so I thought, well, that's interesting. There's no airport, there's no rail link, there's no new road or anything. But what a lot of cities are doing now is simply saying, we have to meet these urbanization targets. We don't want migrants coming into the city anymore and adding to our social roles, right, for social welfare benefits and so forth. We'll just redraw our municipal boundaries. And so one way they're making those targets, you know, they're still farmers, but they're considered urbanites now legally, which I think is really interesting. So there's that aspect of it. And then there's the other aspect of people are choosing to become urbanites. And I think that's one thing that surprised me. I thought after this wave of migration to the coast in the late 1990s, early 2000s, people would have said, well, no, we should stay home now. Life is actually better here, or it's better to be in a third tier city than in Beijing or Shanghai. That really isn't happening yet. Now, having said that, I couldn't find a house to live in Wasteland. I thought everything I had read, you know, you could walk in and just walk into a house, there'd be a cow that needs milking right in front. Everybody went to the cities. But Wasteland is comparatively prosperous, and so some people are coming back there after college. Because if you're classified as a farmer, if you can't find a job in the city, you still hold title to some land back in your village, and you have your house in the village as well.
So that's your job security.
That's job security. Isn't that interesting? And so some people come back to Wasteland, but then they have a car. Some of them have like Porsche SUVs, because it's China, right? And some of them make that 25-mile commute into Jilin City every day, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
One of the things I found very interesting about China is there's no romance of the countryside there.
Not at all.
Yeah, everybody's like, oh my gosh, that's the place you get sent to, you know, during a, you know, Mao's time or something. It's not at all romantic. It's full of outhouses and smelly shit, and we don't ever want to go there, and we want to come back. But do you find a reversal of that now? I mean, what we're hearing right now is complaints about pollution, uh-huh, overcrowding in cities. Is there a change, you know, especially since you're describing such a happy blue sky place?
That's a good question. And in China, I hate the word peasant. I'm glad we're using the word farmers. I think we need to put the word peasant to rest. But Chinese farmers consider themselves manufacturers more than they do farmers, right? People would say to me, everything you're seeing is a manufactured landscape here. This was once, you know, water this deep that was from the Songhua River on a floodplain. People created these paddies and so forth. Everything is manufactured. And I say, oh, it's really pretty. And they say, no, you're looking at a food factory, essentially. We're factory workers. We just produce food. And I'd say, well, you know, in the States, people like to call themselves growers now. And that was just a foreign concept to a Chinese farmer. Like, no, you don't understand. We are factory workers out here. We do this, right? There's no romanticization of the farming profession. And like you said, in the countryside, about being in the countryside, there's no romance. Having said that, though, it's amazing to watch my wife transform, leaving Singapore, Hong Kong, or we came from Manhattan, from New York City when we moved to this area together. And the idea was she'd quit her job in New York City, she'd come with me to this village where her family was, and we'd explore this place together, and I would collect all this lore, and she would just take a year off. Well, she lasted a week. You know, she's like, you've got to be kidding me. I cannot stay here. I'm not using an outhouse. I'm not sleeping on that bed that's heated by rice. I want my career back. And she went on. But part of that, too, is she felt like she was a little girl again. And she felt she was getting the pat on the head and sort of being slotted back into the family. But one thing she taught me that was really interesting, and I see this more and more from people when they talk about the countryside, is that the countryside is still alive to them. It is a living repository of their memories. So every place my wife and I courted and dated in Beijing is gone. We have no legacy to show our son, where we had our first meal, our first movie together, where we went for a walk, right? Completely torn down. But if she goes back to her village, she could show me the exact spot her grandmother would sit her down in the mud or on the dirt, right, while her grandmother seeded the paddy. And for her, like, she would start crying, like, unexpectedly, like, I have a connection back to the past with this place that I could never have in a city. Yeah. But you do see that more and more people with the pollution things, to the point where Eastern Fortune Rice has cashed in on this, and they built a hot spring resort in the village that's modeled on a Japanese resort, ironically, it's a Japanese resort, where city kids come and they can pick organic strawberries, pick organic watermelons, right? And their parents are very happy because they're like, oh, see, they're getting some fresh air and stuff. So there's that weird.
I still remember writing about how Home Depot opened up and nobody's, we're not going to go fix things with our hands, you know?
Exactly.
So
yeah.
This is a really interesting reversal.
Well, to the point where the gardener at the hot spring resort, the kids won't pick the watermelons. They sort of kick at them like soccer balls. And so the parents will say, hey, gardener, come here. Can you pick the watermelon for the kid? Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Pay you five kwai for that.
Right.
I'm glad you brought up your wife, because one of the things that in Manchuria is a love story, isn't it, in a sense? It's
hard to do in about China, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, was this, in a sense, something of wanting to capture where you came from for your son? But you finish off the book talking about news of your son, right?
A new cycle.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wrote one version of the book, and then my wife got pregnant, and I threw away that version and started over. Because it's really different when you're writing not only for a general audience, but I wanted to leave something that would tell my kid, here's what mom and dad were up to before you came here, but more importantly, here's where you come from. Because our son's growing up in Singapore now. It's not the States, it's not China. We wanted to have some connection back to this place. He might not discover that till he's 15. Yeah, we'll see. No. My wife won't let him near China.
And who knows, by that point, they might have condominiums and spas and all sorts of things in Wasteland.
The manager of Eastern Fortune Rice is a big Starbucks drinker. He's a huge Starbucks fan. And Jilin is too small of a city to have Starbucks. And he stated that his mission is to get a Starbucks in Wasteland. Yeah, that he wants to open at the resort. I don't put it past him at all. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to open up the floor to some questions now, because I always think that's really interesting.
Yeah.
Arnold? Yeah.
Hi.
Arnold is from.
Hi, Arnold. Sorry. Okay. My name's Arnold Zeitlin. I've been teaching in China as well.
In Guangzhou, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah.
After I read the book, I felt that what was missing was any much reference to the Communist Party mm-hmm. and its effect on people, on the people you write about. And I wondered if this was a choice you made, or whether it was reflecting the way people felt about the party, because in my experience, people would rather not talk about it.
Yeah, you know, it's really different than Beijing, because I was living on the edge of Tiananmen Square, and people would say, why don't we speak up about the Hutong being destroyed? We were all here in 1989. People ran from the square into our neighborhood. In the village, honestly, it never came up. It never came up. In the index for the book, there are several entries for the Communist Party because of the history of the region and stuff. Oh, there's actually more than that. But in the village itself, everybody knew the village committee, and it was Auntie Yi was one of them. But it was all personal. It was all like, your Cunjiang was you know, Wang Cunjiang. He wasn't the Communist Party. He was just Mayor Wang in that regard. Yeah, and one reason for that may be that a lot of the people that moved to this area were soldiers. They were working at the Air Force base that isn't too far from here, that's been mothballed, now they use it for practice flights. So they had a very different cultural revolution because there were so many soldiers there. Red Guards didn't really come out and raise rabble. And they had a very different 70s and 80s for that reason, too. And so that might be another reason. There isn't a lot of, like, opposition or anger yet at things that have been going on, because it's been a steady trajectory upward there. Yeah. Nominally so, yeah. Not officially, but yeah.
There was
story not told, as far as that's
concerned. Yeah, he has. That's true. So the company is officially owned. It's privately held with different investors. And I did a due diligence report. I paid somebody, hired a lawyer to go through all their files. Was there any suits against them? What's the local press about them and stuff? Who's on the ownership documents and so forth? And what that turned up is it's privately held with backing. And you couldn't tell who all the investors were. It could well be that somebody in the Jilin government's a backer. I don't know. Yeah.
Another question? And maybe you could say a little something about who you are first. Yeah, that would be great.
Ken Dillon. Ken Dillon, Sansia Press.
Hi, Ken. I
noticed that several of the buildings, including where you live, were warm. You described them as warm. How did they get warm, and how did they stay warm? I mean, what was the heating?
That bad. It was all that it was burning dried rice chaff, and then that heat emanating outward. And then we'd seal everything inside with saran wrap, essentially, with those 3M plastic things on the inside, and tape them all shut. But it was all fire. It was all fire heat.
Against
minus 18. It gets so hot in there, you really would sit in shorts and a t-shirt. Yeah, amazing. People aren't romanticizing that, though. Like, my roommate was so happy. The irony is the house I lived in Beijing that I thought I was writing a book about it being torn down is still there, and is now part of a hutong that's full of art galleries. The farmhouse I lived in is gone, and now rice is planted there instead, because my roommate was very happy to go out and get an apartment instead. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Stephen Dutton. I'm a grad student in Asian studies at George Washington. And I've been to China a few times. I lived there for a while, but I've never traveled to the Manchuria area. But I did take the Trans-Siberian up into Siberia, and I read a lot about Siberian literature, things like that. In the Siberian experience. And one of the sort of the great fears of Russian Siberia is that the Chinese will kind of overwhelm what was or is Russian Siberia and have a really, a large Chinese presence there, looking for opportunities that maybe where crowded China is posing problems. There's so much space and nothing really happening in Russian Siberia, so maybe that's a new opportunity for Chinese people. Do you see any evidence of this exodus of Chinese people? I mean, it's a serious concern from the Russian end, from what I saw.
Sure, and from the Chinese side, they'd say, oh, we're just taking back territory that was ours during the Qing Dynasty, because at one point the border went quite further north than the Amur River all the way up to the Pacific coast there. What you see right now, on the border towns, like if you go up to Heihe, which is the northernmost town on a rail line there, there's a little free trade zone on the other side there with an island, with a mall and stuff. But what is happening along that side of the Amur River, the Russian side, is Russian villages and municipalities are leasing out huge tracts of land to Chinese farmers, or more officially, Chinese agribusinesses like Bingtuan, which was one time an army-owned farming group. That's taking on, I talk about this a little bit in the book too, these leases they're taking on over the border to grow produce for shipment back into China, actually. Yeah. So as far as the exodus of people going there, I think it's hard enough to get people to go to Heihe or Suifen or some of these border, Manzhouli for that matter. But yeah, the Chinese often will say like, well, but that was ours during the Qing Dynasty. Right. Yeah.
There is this theory that, this fears that China as it rises is gonna get more militant and more muscular. Who knows, right? Certainly in the Southeast Asian, the East Asian region, they've been more disputes over Diaoyutai and the islands and all. I haven't seen anything about the Siberia, but.
Well, it's a big deal though with food policy because China has huge holdings now, like in Brazil and Argentina. The New York Times had some line that the Chinese investment in Brazilian soybeans has lifted X amount of people out of poverty, right? Because the market is so big there. Ukraine, large leases of land. But then the flip side is happening too, like right outside of Wasteland, like four villages over, Singapore just broke ground on a 500 square mile super farm. They're calling the Jilin Food Zone, which is Singapore backed with Chinese help. But the idea of this 500 miles, that's the size of Los Angeles, by the way, 500 square miles.
Isn't that bigger in Singapore?
It is, and that's the funny thing is that they actually want to raise organic rice and pork for export to Singapore, because Singapore has its resource issues. So it's like on the one hand, China's outreaching outside of its borders, but on the other hand, other countries are reaching inside to China. I'm sure there's a quid pro quo here behind the scenes of what China will get from Singapore in exchange for this, but, and we'll see if it ever comes to anything too. Just because you break ground doesn't mean it will happen. Yeah. Hi.
I guess I'll go first. My name is Alina, and I've done a lot of work in international development, not really in China. But it's interesting what you're bringing up, because there's a lot of parallels talking with Africa in terms of the elderly farming and issues between rural and urban. But I was curious in what you were talking about, first of all, if you were an English teacher, because you didn't explain what kind of teaching you were doing to
English.
The kids, and then also what the attitudes were towards you as an American, because I'm assuming that it was fairly rare for them to have Americans, or is that wrong? Is there a special attitude because of the U.S. and what their sense is about that?
I think overwhelmingly in the last 20 years of China, being an American is an asset. People are quite friendly towards you about that. In this region, it was interesting because people immediately wanted to have the Korean War, for example, and that drew people out. The 16-year-old soldier I talked about fought against the Americans. I talk about that in the book. He didn't really fight, but he was there. And then the history of Japan and everything else. What was different in the village than being in Beijing and saying I'm an American is in the village, when people would see you in the middle of nowhere, like I must look, this Dr. Spidel, when I was a Peace Corps volunteer, Dr. Spidel was waiting for me 20 years ago in Sichuan. And you had a line, I don't know if you remember this, you said, when people see you walking down the street, think of a kangaroo bouncing down your hometown street. That's a similar reaction, right, of shock. And so in Beijing, someone would see me and say, you know, where are you from? But always in the Northeast, somebody would say, whose family do you belong to? Right, and so they were slotting me inside my clan much more than they were internationally, which I thought was interesting. Yeah, yeah. I never got anything positive or negative actually for a while because I had cold water. I had a big, huge beard for a while, like a hive of bees beard, like ugh. And one time I shaved, and I was at a hotel, and I shaved, and I came back, and I saw a shopkeeper, and she said, "Oh, where you been?" And I said, "Oh, you know, I've been working and running around." She said, "Oh, there's been a Libyan walking around here." And I said, "A Libyan?" And she said, "Yeah, this guy looks like you, but he's got this big black beard." And Libya happened to be the news that summer, you know, so that was it. I was like, all this time they've been thinking I'm a Libyan? But okay, we'll play that too, yeah. Hi, Isaac, long time no see. I'm doing well, you look great.
Thank you, you too. Actually, I also wanted to ask about Americans, but she covered that. So I'm wondering, how long did it take for people to get used to the idea of you coming to their village and writing a book? I mean, was
good
that
question.
A very weird thing for them, or did it seem normal?
It was the exact same as in Beijing, and it was the exact same as in Sichuan when I was a Peace Corps volunteer. It wasn't until I left and came back that people went, "Oh, never mind." When I was there, the first go-round, it's, "What's he doing? What's he eating? Where's he been? What's going on? Who's his phone? Who's visiting him?" That sort of stuff. When you leave, people go back around their lives. And then when you come back, there's a sort of surprise of like, "Oh, you live here. Oh, you came back. Okay." And then they forget it. Really, it's amazing. In each of the scenarios, I found the best thing to do isn't to try to stay on for 3 months and get to know everybody, introduce yourself. Stay for a while, pull out, and come back. And Frances, my wife, was in Hong Kong working, and so I was making this really awful commute quite often, you know, once a month at least. And I always felt when I got back, that first week was always the best reporting I could do, because people were completely at ease. Like, "Oh, you're back, whatever," and they would ignore me. Yeah. Marshall?
My name's Marshall Lee. I just wonder whether you come across any Christians and people like that, because as I recall, the Catholic Church used to have pretty strong presence in the Northeast. Thank you.
Very good question. There's a French Catholic cathedral that remains in Jilin City. There's in the book I write about a Virgin Mary grotto in Jilin City that exists from a French priest. There aren't Buddhist carvings in the Northeast, or many Buddhist temples for that matter, but there's a lot of churches, the Scottish Presbyterian, Irish Presbyterian. Go back to something Arnold said earlier. I did make a choice to omit something from this book, actually, on my coverage, and it wasn't about the party, but it was about the North Koreans who live in this area. There are villages all around Wasteland, especially one quite near to my house, where North Koreans have come over illegally and have settled there, because Korea, one thing I don't have time for in this talk, see when you read the book, Korea plays an enormous role in this part of the country, including bringing rice and cultivating rice for the first time in the 1910s and 1920s. So there are North Koreans there. There's a Christian church in Wasteland, which I chose not to write about because the penitent, they said, "Please don't. We're a church. It looks like a church. It has a cross." They said, "We'd rather not be written about," even though I'd go to service there. So I chose to leave that out. There aren't Buddhist temples or Taoist temples in this area, but there's a Christian church. Isn't that interesting? And when the only time I got in trouble with the police or sort of questioned by the police was after 2 years, they called me in and said, "Are you a missionary?" And I had to prove to them I wasn't. And the way I did that was I showed them on their computers my Beijing book, pictures of me teaching in Beijing, right? And I remember one police officer actually said, like, "Oh, you're only a writer." And it was the only time I'd heard that in China. Like, that's a relief, right? I'm not a missionary. But yeah, that's a story I didn't want to disclose, but it's there, definitely. Good question.
I am a member for UNESCO Task Force for Intangible Cultural Heritage.
Oh, fantastic.
And 2 years ago, I was in Dalian for a conference for cultural and creative industries. And we suggested that we ask first if there is thorough documentation of intangible cultural heritage, in particular from that area. So they were hesitant to talk about it. Maybe I misunderstood, because I was surprised somehow, and because, well, they are somehow fan of UNESCO, but
oh, yes.
When I was asking about locals in this area with invasions, Russian, Japanese, only, you said, 400 years of history, is there a reason why, or my question, I did not formulate well my question, but then you documented high definition in promote, and
sure.
Japanese came there, the first high-tech IT type of subsourcing, you know.
Yeah.
So everything was in place, they could place. Is there, what is the explanation, or maybe misunderstanding on my side?
Well, it's interesting, I mean, a lot of things in China, if it's not, you know, Han Chinese culture, it's not necessarily volunteered right away as, oh, this is cultural heritage or intangible cultural heritage. And there's an argument, or sort of, I wouldn't say an argument, but a conflict with that UNESCO site not far from Dalian, the Kuguru tombs, those ziggurat-like tombs that are shared by North Korea and China, right, who owns that patrimony. But because everything, when you said intangible cultural heritage in the Northeast, everything I flashed on was Manchu heritage. Or it was indigenous forms of opera. There's a crosstalk comedic opera called Ar Ren Juan, which is very popular in the Northeast, that would count as intangible cultural heritage. But again, that's not something like paper cuts or Peking opera. You know what I mean? It's not, it doesn't have the beauty or the pedigree of those other things. I'm happy to send you a list if you'd like some suggestions. Yeah, in the back. We have time for one more.
Thank you. I'm Jerry Schroff. I'm an educator, but I've been to China and Tibet, and so I was interested in this. I really wondered what happened to the three girls that you showed the picture of who went back to the countryside, and you said you were going to follow up on them. And I
Good question. I should end the slide with them sometime. So the kids I taught in Beijing, now I'm writing their, you know, recommendation letters for university and stuff, which was odd because some of them did not sit for the college entrance exam. They went to paid colleges instead, right? The students who stayed in Beijing all got placed into a national level university. They did quite well. The students who left Beijing and went back to the countryside, I'm sorry to say, many of them, if they're continuing their studies, are going to paid schools. Or they got into places like Yinzhou, or is it Jinzhou? North of Beidaihe, that little town. They went to like second tier, third tier regional universities as opposed to a Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, Chengdu, Wuhan sort of thing. Yeah, so there's a huge difference there. There's a big paper coming out by a bunch of Stanford educational researchers talking about that enormous chasm if you track kids who maybe go back and they're with mom or grandma and grandpa, aunt and uncle, oh, their lives are happy and stuff. And even if they score really high on the entrance exam, their quotas are so much different from those areas than they are from Beijing or Shanghai or bigger cities. They don't have places. Even if they score high enough, they won't be given a place in a really quote-unquote good school. I don't know if this is going to matter so much in 20 years because Chinese tertiary education is going through such, I think, positive reforms. But it is a gulf right now for those kids. And the 18-year-olds, you know, they're devastated by this. Their friends are all going to school in Beijing or Shanghai, and now they're going to places like Yinzhou, you know. Is that what it is? I don't even know the name of the town. Yeah, well, Jinzhou, yeah.
I used to think that before moving to China, living there, working, I used to think, wow, the Chinese system is very meritocratic. You just do sitting exams, and how well you do goes to the next level. But of course, I discovered when I went there, it really wasn't the case at all. Where you come from, where your household registration is, really does help in terms of getting you those crucial extra points. And yeah. It makes a difference between you going to the equivalent of the Harvard of China or...
the Arkansas State. Yeah. Nothing against Arkansas State, yeah, but it's, but yeah.
Yeah, it really is. So, yeah, it's not meritocratic. It isn't as yeah. much as we think we are.
That's another book, by the way.
I have one question. Yeah, Singapore, the disappearing idiot. You mentioned that the title is a Manchuria. You said the word Manchuria has a sort of a romantic connotation, something like Timbuktu, and you know, the sort of Samarkand, those kind of places of you know, somewhere exotic and so what do you think it is about Manchuria that's sort of sexy and unknown and sort of beckoning? Yeah.
There's so many, you know, for a while there, like from 1880 to 1935. Maybe up till Manchukuo, it was a prize for explorers to reach. You know, to go out on the train there, to reach it by foot. A lot of Americans made the journey. In the book, I talk about some of these travelers who did it. So it did once have this sort of cultural cachet of getting there. And in the old days, you know, like Harbin was once the most international city in Asia. It had 53 nationalities, speaking 43 languages or something. I should say that the Chinese version of this book will not use Manchuria in the title, because Manchuria to a Chinese speaker doesn't mean anything today. If you say Manzhou even, it doesn't have the same connotation as Dongbei does today, because now when you talk about the Manchu where they're from, when you talk about Japanese occupation, when you talk about 18th century history, the Chinese history books use Dongbei. Even though in the past it's had different names, like Dongshanshan, the three eastern provinces and so forth. Now it's all Dongbei, 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 northeast, northeast, northeast. And so the title of the book in Chinese, there's a very famous Chinese book called Journey to the West. Mm. So this book in Chinese is Journey to the Northeast, a sort of play on that, which the Chinese publisher is happy. They're like, oh, Chinese readers will get that.
I was kind of curious about this part you mentioned about having a book out in Chinese. Are there any requests to sort of change and alter any content?
So far, I'm up against one, and it's not what I thought it would be. I thought it would be all the Manchukuo history. I thought it would be Japanese occupation. I thought it would be the local historian trying to get Japanese, you know, civilian deaths marked. There was a horrible, quote-unquote, battle called the Siege of Changchun in 1948, where the Communist Army, led by Lin Biao, the man who wrote or put together Mao's Little Red Book, encircled the city of Changchun, which was once the provincial capital of Manchukuo, trapped the civilian population inside, trapped the Kuomintang soldiers inside there, and a communist general who wrote a book about it, the book was banned, called Red Blood, White Snow, said Hiroshima took 5 seconds and killed 160,000 people, estimated. Changchun took 5 months and killed 160,000 people by starving them. And so that is a passage in the book where I talk to survivors of that era, and that's one thing right now. I'm holding firm on it. I can't take it out. It's a crucial historical nugget of why the Northeast became what it did.
What,
did they want to take it out?
Yeah, did they say?
Because you can't. There's no official history of this in Taiwan. There is, but you can't say that. The official history is the Northeast fell without firing a single shot. Yeah, well, it's true. Because they starve the soldiers out. So that's, yeah, if I put this
in
here.
I'm surprised that's the only thing so far that they're...
That's the only thing in the whole book, believe it or not. Oh. But it's a big sticking point. And maybe that's why they know that. And now I'm going to horse trade. I don't want to horse trade, though. Yeah, that's a whole other topic.
Yeah, so it may or may
not. Yeah.
One last question from anyone, you think?
Mm-hmm. No, I'll be around, too. If you guys want to talk afterwards, I'm happy to. Oh, yes. Okay. Please.
I wonder, did you feel anything or did you hear anything about Chinese dream? And they said, how does it relate to local area, specific to this part?
I hear about this a lot. I was in Beijing last week, and I hear a lot about it there in the countryside now. I hear about the new socialist countryside. That's what you hear out there all the time. We're building the new socialist countryside, new farmers, new agriculture. Yeah, but Chinese dream is more on the national stage, yeah. Thanks so much for coming, everybody. Bye.